Hello, my name is Shawn Conley, and I'm a state soybean and small grain specialist at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Today, we're going to discuss many questions related to soybean growth and development, and how, by understanding soybean growth and development, you can make keen crop management decisions. To begin with, I want to lay the base framework for soybean yield and what it is a function of. If you look at soybean management and soybean yield potential, it's a combination of genetic yield potential, agronomic management, and environment. If you look at many of the models predicted in describing soybean yield, you can basically parse the genetic yield gain over the last 80 years for soybean based on 50% genetic potential and 50% changes in agronomic management. The genetic yield potential would be variety selection and that general 0.3 to 0.4 bushels per acre per year yield gain just through breeding efforts. And then you combine that with agronomic management practices such as earlier planting dates, seed treatments, better soil fertility and management practices, and pest management to give us the other half of our genetic yield gain. Of course, both of those factors, genetic yield potential and agronomic management, are always trumped by the environment, be it the water, the temperature, or some of the questions related to climate change or climate variability in these years. So what I want to do is address how soybean management and truly understanding growth and development under these three frameworks can help us better manage our soybean crop moving forward. Again, if we had to prioritize the soybean yield varietal characteristics when you're going through and selecting variety, obviously if you look at what growers are paid for right now, it's on yield. Well, in a few short slides, we'll be discussing how to properly select a soybean variety. But again, we want to base most of our primary decision on yield. The second decision growers need to understand is what are the disease resistance characteristics that meet their means and their demands in their specific fields. Next, we'll be discussing the maturity group limitations or what maturity group growers should be selecting based on their geography within the state of Wisconsin. And lastly, grain composition. Now, we are fortunate in the state of Wisconsin to have about 10 to 12% of our acres be food grade soybeans. So again, in those situations, grain composition moves up right behind yield in terms of varietal characteristics. So please contact your supplier if you're looking with grain composition questions. And lastly is lodging, but the breeding efforts have really done a good job over the last 20 to 25 years of really limiting our lodging constraints in soybean production. To claim what growers are interested in, we took a survey basically 5 years ago amongst several hundred growers to really look at what are they looking for when they select a soybean variety. And by far and away, they're mainly dependent on yield potential. After that is disease resistance. And then their interest is plus or minus a glyphosate or Roundup Ready trait. Those growers that are non-GMO or food grade obviously are going to be selecting for those varieties that are not GMOs or have that trait in it. Or other growers looking at simple fillings for their weed management strategies will be able to address and use some of that trait to use glyphosate as a tool, as a management tool in their weed management system. After that, dealer recommendations. And again, seed price really falls way down on the list. And based on that information, what you'll soon see, I would agree with growers that, again, they should be looking at yield potential first and really not spending as much time addressing the whole issue of seed price and making their decisions. One of the other key characteristics I like to remind growers is, over the same land-based area, an average number of soybean varieties a grower will plant will be 2.3. On the flip side, growers will normally plant 4.6 acres. So one of the challenges I see with growers is they're really limiting their genetic yield potential that they're putting across their land-based area by half. And that really minimizes their influence of the variety selection. So I strongly encourage growers as we move forward into 2015 and beyond to really spend more time on focusing on the variety selection and also really pick more than 2 to 3 varieties to help mitigate some of the environmental stresses that we're seeing given some of these climate variability questions we are seeing today. One of the key tools we like to talk to growers in the state of Wisconsin is our Wisconsin Soybean Variety Test Results, UW Extension Publication A3654. This is a compilation of variety trial results that is unbiased and takes all companies into task to be able to identify which varieties across any company platform performs the best over a wide range of environmental and geographical locations across the state of Wisconsin. I just want to quickly take you through how you would interpret this book in case you are interested in downloading it off of our webpage, or you have access to it through many of the multiple newspapers that published this article in early December. If we go from left to right, we always have the brand, and we identify these in alphabetical order, so it would be easy for a grower or a crop consultant to go through and identify and find the specific variety that are of interest. Next, we have the entry or the number of that variety. The third column is a maturity group, a relative maturity group given to that variety by the company. The next title or the next column is the single year multi-location yields. Basically what this is it's a combination of all of the single site locations across a specific region. We also label the maturity dates that we record at R8, and this gives growers an idea of when these soybeans are physiologically mature. So when they're looking at the maturity group, they have a better decision on how well that maturity group relates to that actual time when that soybean plant is maturity. We next have individual site year locations. In this example, we have our Arlington, East Troy, and Platteville sites, which is in our southern region. So it gives growers a sense of where the sites are and individual performance across those individual sites. We also publish protein and oil composition for those growers interested in oil quality characteristics in making their marketing decisions. And we finally publish the previous year's results for those growers that are trying to get multi-year, multi-location data. Now, one of the things that we provide with this is some of the statistics behind really understanding if a variety is truly different than another one. And we have two specific things we'd like to address here. First of all is our LSD level. So in this example here, an LSD of 5 says that any two yields differing more than or equal to 5 bushels are significantly different. If they're less than 5 bushels, then they are not statistically different. So that gives you a sense of whether or not two specific varieties, if you're trying to make a decision, are truly the same or different. In an effort to kind of help facilitate and push growers or help growers easily identify the high-yielding varieties, we have these yields that are preceded by a star. And these starred varieties mean they are not statistically different than the highest-yielding variety at either a given location or within a given region. Again, this helps growers have a better understanding in order to help identify those high-yielding varieties right off the bat. So one of the choices we also give growers is based on their latitude within the state of Wisconsin, what relative maturity you should be planting. So again, based on your county, based on what part of the state of Wisconsin you live, this is a relative idea of what the relative maturity is. So for an example, if you live in Dane County or farm in Jefferson County, the optimal maturity group range the grower should be looking at or deciding to plant in that specific region is anywhere from a 1.7 to a 2.5 maturity group soybean. As you move further north, say to Marathon County, then that relative maturity shrinks down from a 0.0 to a 1.4. Again, it helps growers make that decision and kind of hone in on what maturity groups would be best perform in their specific geographic region. So one of the things we were able to do is by having this database of information, understand what is the optimal soybean maturity group for yield. So we went through the last 7 to 8 years of our soybean variety trial book, and we were able to identify what is the optimal maturity group yield for those growers in the southern region of Wisconsin. So again, that would basically be from the northern Dane County line south. And based on our data, for optimal or maximum yield, growers should be planting somewhere between a 2.6 and a 2.9 maturity group. However, I always wanted to warn growers and impress upon them that that is just for maximum yield, and I would not encourage any grower to go out and plant 2,000 to 4,000 acres of a 2.8 soybean and expect to get them harvested in a timely manner given the fall climate that we often deal with in the state of Wisconsin. What I also want to have growers remind them for is we have a very broad shoulder, if you will, in terms of what that maturity group range is for yield. If you look back in our 2014 soybean variety test, and the starred varieties range anywhere from a 1.9 to a 2.8 maturity group. So again, what that tells us is that though our maximum maturity group range for yield is a 2.6 to 2.9. Growers can select varieties if they use a mechanism like our soybean Varietal book all the way down to a 1.9 and still get the same yields. So I'm really strongly encouraging growers to go into the system, go into our Varietal book, pick about 20% of their land base acres, put out there at an early 1.9, 40 to 60% of their acres they can go with a 2.4, let's say a 2.3 to a 2.5 maturity group, and then maybe the other 20 to 30% of their acres they can go to a 2.6 to a 2.8. What that allows growers to really do is A, diversify their genetic pool across their land base area, and also allows them to kind of deal with some of the environmental characteristics based on early or late season rains and really trying to capture some of that variability that we see in the environment to really overall maximize yield over their entire production system. I want to switch quickly into soil test phosphorus interpretation categories. I know Dr. Lebowski had already covered this in her section, but I'd like to just remind people that in her publication, A2809, Nutrient Application Guidelines for Field Vegetable Fruit Crops in Wisconsin, what the optimal soil test range is for soybean in a loamy and a sandy soil. So that would be somewhere in a loamy sand or a loamy soil between a 16 and 20 parts per million, and for sand, 23 to 32. Similarly, on the potassium side, on a soybean production system, we're looking at 101 to 130 on a loamy and 66 to 90 on a sand. So again, I just want to remind growers, crop consultants, to be able to utilize this research and understand what this optimal soil test range is, and make sure you manage your soybean production systems accordingly to be able to take advantage of these soil tests, and recommend that you take regular soil test sampling in order to make sure we're not limiting our soybean production system by limiting the amount of nutrients we're putting out across our land base area. With that, I'd like to remind growers, if they have any further questions, please go to my webpage, which is coolbean.info. You can follow me at Badgerbean, which is Twitter, or go to my blog, which is thesoyreport.blogspot.com.